don't need to say welcome because Anoop is an alumnus of Nalsal. He's in fact, if nothing else, at some point of time, he was the one welcoming me here. So that's a different point. So Anoop studied here between 2001 and 2006. After that, he's pursued his higher studies at the University of Oxford. He submitted his dissertation, which looks at questions of subclassification within affirmative action in India. And for the last 5 years, he's been teaching at NMU Delhi. Alongside his teaching, he's also become quite well known for his ongoing research on capital punishment. And now, what was initially a smaller group looking at the state of prisoners on death row has grown into a considerable project. In fact, he engages full-time research associates who are helping him with this research. So when the students decided to look out for speakers as part of this series, obviously it takes some time and planning to put together a series of this kind, and now we are having the 8th and possibly the last lecture as part of this series for this year. So it's only befitting that we have our first Nalsal alumnus who will be speaking as part of this series. Right. So without wasting much more time, Anoop, over to you.
Yeah, good evening everyone, and thank you for having me here. It's certainly very different from the time at which I left this place, and all changes seem to be for the better, so that's good. Anyway, it's great to be back, and what I'm going to be, and I really do wish that I had come back to talk about something more pleasant, because nothing I'm going to say today even remotely comes close to being pleasant. So I apologize for that at the very outset. And I do hope to get you thinking on many things. They're not easy questions, and the answers are certainly not comfortable for any of us, but just a I need to put all my cards on the table. Much of what I'm going to say arises from, of course, a sort of doctrinal understanding of death penalty, cases on the death penalty, philosophical writing on the death penalty, but much of that has been colored by my experience with the Death Penalty Research Project, interviewing death row prisoners across the country since 2013 and getting the report out last year with a bunch of incredible students, I must say, without whom this project would not have been done. All of them around your age, we really pushed them to get this done, and it was incredible. And we now litigate and we represent death row prisoners. We represent about 60 death row prisoners across the country out of the university with the center, and we do research projects. And the only reason for saying all this is that you know that I come from a certain perspective, right? I'm going to try and be as objective and as academic as I can about this, but it's a hat that I rarely get to wear given the work we do, right? So pardon me if this sounds a bit one-sided, but I'm trying to go and make it as even as I can, right? So before I start, I just want to read out two excerpts from this case, Callens versus Collins, in the US Supreme Court in 1994. I want to read just one paragraph from Blackmun's dissenting opinion and Scalia's, now the late Justice Scalia's concurring opinion, just to show how very often this debate gets matched up, right? So Blackmun says, on February 23rd, 1994, at approximately 1 a.m., Bruce Edwin Callens will be executed by the state of Texas. Intravenous tubes attached to his arms will carry the instrument of death, a toxic fluid designed specifically for the purpose of killing human beings. The witnesses, standing a few feet away, will behold Callens, no longer a defendant, an appellant or a petitioner, but a man, strapped to a gurney and seconds away from extinction. Within days, or perhaps hours, the memory of Callens will begin to fade. The wheels of justice will churn again, and somewhere another jury or another judge will have the unenviable task of determining whether some human being is to live or die. We hope, of course, that the defendant whose life is at risk will be represented by competent counsel, someone who is inspired by the awareness that a less than vigorous defense truly could have fatal consequences for the defendant. We hope that the attorney will investigate all aspects of the case, follow all evidentiary and procedural rules, and appear before a judge who is still committed to the protection of defendant's rights, even now as the prospect of meaningful judicial oversight has diminished. In the same vein, we hope that the prosecution, in urging the penalty of death, will have exercised its discretion wisely, free from bias, prejudice, or political motive, and will be humbled rather than emboldened by the awesome authority conferred by the state. So you know where Blackmun is going, right? Blackmun started out with as being a votary of the death penalty, and over the course of his judicial career in the Supreme Court comes in Callens and Collins to end with saying that he shall no longer tinker with the machinery of death. And that's how that opinion finishes. But let's see how Scalia puts the same thing. And Scalia is with the majority in this case. And Scalia says, convictions in opposition to the death penalty are often passionate and deeply held. That will be no excuse for reading them into a constitution that does not contain them, even if they represented the convictions of a majority of Americans. Much less, is there any excuse for using that course to thrust a minority's views upon the people? Justice Blackmun begins his statement by describing with poignancy the death of a convicted murderer by lethal injection. He chooses, as the case in which to make that statement, one of the less brutal of the murders that regularly come before us. The murder of a man ripped by a bullet suddenly and unexpectedly, with no opportunity to prepare himself and his affairs, and left to bleed to death on the floor of a tavern. The death by injection, which Justice Blackmun describes, looks pretty desirable next to that. It looks even better next to some of the other cases currently before us, which Justice Blackmun did not select as the vehicle for his announcement that the death penalty is always unconstitutional. For example, the case of the 11-year-old girl raped by four men and then killed by stuffing her panties down her throat. He's referring to McCallum, this is North Carolina, pending before the court then. How enviable a quiet death by lethal injection compared with that? If the people conclude that such more brutal deaths may be deterred by capital punishment, indeed, if they merely conclude that justice requires such brutal deaths to be avenged by capital punishment, the creation of a false, untextual, and unhistorical contradiction within the court's Eighth Amendment jurisprudence should not prevent them, right? So you see what both these judges are doing, and I think it's these two opinions are fantastic in judicial craft, right? You see the language they're using, you see the tone they're using, you see the examples they're picking up, and it's a fascinating face-off between the two in terms of how they say what is happening in this case. And I think what Scalia says is something for us to think about, right? If the people want it, if the people feel that there is going to be deterrence, so be it. Who is the court to say anything else, right? It may be statistically proven, it may not be statistically proven. If the people feel that, so be it. And even if it is not about deterrence, even if this argument is not about deterrence, even if this argument is about vengeance, even if this argument is about revenge, Scalia poses the question, what is wrong with that? If the people democratically decide that we want death penalty as vengeance, what is wrong with that? Right? And I think the abolitionist side has to have an answer to that, right? You can't just wave that off, right? You can't wave that off. And I'm not saying I have some great mind-boggling answer to the questions that Scalia poses, right? But that is the difficulty. And I think we will all do ourselves a favor, irrespective of whether we are in favor of the death penalty or against the death penalty, to be honest about the reasons for our positions. If you are in favor of the death penalty, is vengeance driving it? Then if it is vengeance is driving it, then let's have a conversation about revenge. Let's just have a conversation about revenge in a criminal justice system and whether revenge should drive a criminal justice system. Instead of trying to package it with some other things, right? So I would just like to set that out at the beginning and leave that thought with you before I proceed to much of what I have to say, right? This lecture is not going to be about the rarest of the rare, right? I'm not going to talk to you about the inconsistency in the application of the rarest of the rare. I don't need to say anything about it. The Supreme Court itself acknowledges that the rarest of the rare has broken down. I'm not going to say anything about it, and that is why the lecture is titled the way it is, sort of reimagining the constitutional questions around the death penalty. So I'm not going to tell you anything about how the rarest of the rare is inconsistent and how it's broken and all of that. And I'm going to just try and stay clear of that, right? But much of what I have to say does turn around the question of, is the death penalty unique as a punishment, right? What makes the death penalty as a punishment? What makes it different from, let's say, incarceration? Asking somebody to live in prison for 25 years, 30 years, 40 years, how many ever years, what makes it different, right? And I propose that its uniqueness does not lie really in its irreversibility, right? It's that the uniqueness of the death penalty does not lie in the fact that life once taken cannot be given back. Of course, I mean, that is an obvious thing, but I don't think its uniqueness is attached to the irreversibility of the punishment. And it does not attach itself to the irreversibility of the punishment, because if you attach it to irreversibility, you're almost committing to the position that death penalty is a problem only in cases of wrongful convictions. Right? If you say the problem with the death penalty is that you might take life and you should not have taken that life, you come very close to saying that the objection to the death penalty then is limited to wrongful convictions, when you got the wrong person, right? But I think the objection to the death penalty is a much broader one. It's not just in terms of saying we should not give, the argument is not that we should not give death penalty to innocent people, right? That's not the argument, right? The argument is that we should not give death penalty full stop, right? Even if they are guilty of the worst of the worst crimes, right? And I think the uniqueness of the death penalty really, as a punishment, as compared to incarceration for a definite period or an indefinite period, I would think lies in that oscillation between life and death on an everyday basis, right? That's where its uniqueness lies. As a punishment, it is particularly cruel, right? Because you leave a set of individuals who are sentenced to this punishment constantly not knowing whether they're going to live or die, right? And that uncertainty, that everyday uncertainty that prisoners face while on death row, that for me, I think, makes the death penalty a very unique punishment, a very different punishment from incarceration. And that's what sets it apart for me, really. And I think in discussions of the death penalty, there is a certain comfortable distance that we all assume from the punishment. And what do I mean by that? The comfortable distance from this punishment is that the way the theater of this entire punishment plays out, for all of us sitting here, it is something that we will never see, right? It is something that will never be shown to us. The state will never show how somebody is being executed, right? You have this abstract image in your head of, yes, this person is going to be hanged. There is this black hood as they will show on TV, and then they will pull the lever, and then the trap doors will open, and then the person will fall down. Right? It's a very comfortable, abstract position from which to think about what is happening. Because nobody is going to show you the eyes popping out, the tongue coming out, people shitting in their pants as they dangle there, struggling, and the asphyxiation that comes with such punishment. You're not going to see all of that. Right? And therefore, it is easy in that sense. It's easy in that sense to reduce this to an abstract debate. Right? That distance allows you, right, to make this issue really about a set of arguments and nothing else, and not about disgust, not about emotion, not about anger, not about sympathy. All of that goes out of the window. It comes down to a bunch of arguments, right? Now, having said all of this, having set it up in this manner in terms of its uniqueness, in terms of the optics of the death penalty and the distance that all of us have from this punishment of not really having to routinely see this, or you know, when somebody is hanged, we don't have to see it, right? And having set it up like that, before I get into the India-specific discussion, there is a particular difficulty to discussing the death penalty in India, right? And what is that? And it's something that we've constantly faced in our work. The difficulty is that we operate in a country where extrajudicial executions, summary executions, are legitimized, right? Something like that does not receive the kind of critical inquiry that it should. In that context, when state power at that level goes unchallenged and is legitimized, this discussion on procedural fairness, on philosophical undesirability, right, all becomes a much more difficult conversation to have within the country, right? Because when you find that itself difficult to challenge, something, I mean, this is not to get into comparison of which is worse or which is better, but you can guess what I'm trying to imply here, right? That this discussion is somewhere seen as a discussion of luxury, right? At least there is a legal procedure, right? At least there is a semblance of judicial process. At least there is a semblance of a mercy petition. There are all these judicial remedies that you have. Then what are you complaining about, right? The second issue that I want to sort of, the broad overarching issue is that politically the death penalty gets used even by groups that tend to disproportionately bear the burden of the death penalty. What do I mean by that, right? If you take the example of the Khairlanji killings, right, or the Khairlanji massacre, a family of Dalits raped, massacred, brutally murdered, right? There, Dalit groups wanted the death penalty, right? Whereas the narrative, the dominant narrative, is that the death penalty disproportionately impacts Dalits and OBCs, right? And the minority groups, right? Well, not minority groups, Muslims. Right? So that is the narrative. That is the dominant narrative. But when it comes to something like the Khairlanji massacre, or when it comes to something like the Bara massacre, right, in Bihar, right? Right? There, again, Dalits are on death row. There is opposition as to why is it only that Dalits are on death row in the Bara massacre case, where the Dalits were prosecuted and under Tada and for many, many years were on death row, and until recently the president commuted their death sentence after their mercy petition was lost for about 15 years, right? Compared to the Lakshmanpur Bathe massacre, right, where the upper caste had massacred Dalits, right, and when they were acquitted by the Patna High Court, right, there was a similar saying, you know, the, a call for harsher punishments. And I think this does nobody any favors, right, when the very victims of the system, in that sense, start legitimizing the punishment by demanding it, right? It raises very difficult political questions for a discussion on the death penalty, right? Similarly, sexual violence, right? Sexual violence and terrorism are the main drivers of the death penalty and the renewed interest in the death penalty in this country. And as you are all aware, the December 16th death penalty appeals are going on in the Supreme Court, right? Even there, I mean, of course there is a movement, there's a slightly progressive movement from the time when Dhananjay Chatterjee was executed, there was serious division within the women's rights movement as to whether the death penalty should be there or not, right? And when you come to December 16th, you can see a palpable difference in the position that women's rights organizations took, right? And even before the Verma Commission, that they shouldn't have the death penalty for rape, right? But even there, you see this response to state violence as some groups still demanding the death penalty for rape, right? And politically it's very problematic. It's problematic because you have groups who are subject to state violence demanding more state violence, right? Wanting to legitimize a certain form of state violence, right? Now, having said this, right, and please remember these larger points that I have made while I get into the legal part of this now, and please place these things in that context, right? The first thing that I would like to address is certain basic constitutional provisions and statutory provisions that need changing, right? Which really don't make any constitutional sense, right? Given the reality that we have faced so far. The first thing, I mean, and really, this really should be a low-hanging fruit, is that the Supreme Court can dismiss death penalty special leave petitions in limine. Right? What does that mean? Right? It means that it need not admit when a death penalty appeal comes before it for the first time as a special leave petition. It need not admit it. It need not hear it on merits. It can dismiss it in limine and say, we don't want to hear this. Right? Right? And the latest instance being in 2015 when the same bench dismissed four death sentences in limine. Four death sentences in one day. While they didn't dismiss many other death sentences in limine, who knows? You mean, who knows what went wrong that day that they decided that these four death sentences will not be heard, right? We don't want to hear the merits, right? And this is not some sort of, oh, why can't they hear it, you know, they should hear it argument. There is a very good constitutional reason as to why they have to hear it now, right? And that is because of the decision in Mohammad Arif, right? Mohammad Arif is sentenced to death for attack on the Red Fort, right? So in Mohammad Arif's case, the question was whether a death penalty review petition after the Supreme Court has confirm the death sentence in the criminal appeal, right? First is a criminal appeal, and then you go to the review petition, and then you go to the curative petition. Whether the Supreme Court must mandatorily hear the review petition in open court. The normal practice with review petitions is that they are heard and disposed of in chambers. Right? There is no open court hearing for review petitions unless the judges decide that they must be heard in open court. Right? So the challenge in Mohammed Arif was that all death penalty review petitions must be heard in open court. Right? And Justice Nariman writing the majority opinion, with Chalameshwar dissenting, right? Said that affirming the special nature of death penalty as a punishment, said that given the unique nature of this punishment, and given the fact that different judges can come to different conclusions on the point of whether somebody should be sentenced to death or not, we must hear death penalty review petitions in open court. Right? That there must be arguments in the review petition, and that death penalty review petitions are a separate category from all other review petitions that come before us. Right? It is untenable for the court to have both these positions. To say that yes, there must be open court hearing in death penalty review petitions, but yet we will retain with ourselves and exercise our power to dismiss death penalty criminal appeals in limine. When you dismiss it in limine, you just write dismiss. There's nothing. Right? There are no reasons. They just write dismissed. Now, if you are saying that I have a right to be heard in open court, if my review petition can be heard in open court, and whereas in the proceeding before that, all I have is one word, dismissed, what is this court going to review? It's mind-boggling sometimes how inconsistent they can be. I mean, of course, there is a problem in raising a constitutional challenge on this and saying that all death penalty appeals have to be mandatorily heard because of the constitutional provision which says that the court has discretion whether to admit a SLP or not. Right? So when you can't now go and argue that, you know, you can't exercise that power, right? But then it only makes sense for the court to develop an internal practice that, yes, when there is a death penalty criminal appeal, we will hear it on merits. Right? And this is a constitutional reason. The sort of other organizational reason is given the kind of SLPs they hear and the number of SLPs that they hear, it really is no justification to say that a person's life is not worth hearing. Right? And this is, as far as I'm concerned, at least from where I look at this, it's a pretty low-hanging fruit. Right? The next biggest problem is of legal representation and legal aid, right? As those of you who have studied constitutional law, you'll know that the right to free legal aid and a gap in the jurisprudence of the court has developed on this is that the right to free legal aid commences only when you're produced before the magistrate after 24 hours of custody, right? While the constitution guarantees the right to consult a lawyer in custody, the court's jurisprudence on free legal aid does not cover free legal aid at the time of police custody. Right? And we would all be seriously naive to think that everybody is kept in police custody only for 24 hours before being produced. Right? I mean, I hope none of us are under that illusion that you're picked up, you're kept only for 24 hours and you're duly produced before the magistrate. That's certainly not what happens, right? With the prisoners that we met and even generally with literature abound, the practice is that you're kept in illegal detention for how many ever days before the document shows the date of arrest as 24 hours before being produced. Yes, the document will show that you were arrested 24 hours, but in reality, you're basically abducted and kept for hours or days or weeks before that, right? And much of what I'm going to say now will point to a deep crisis in the criminal justice system. And the question that I want all of you to ponder about is that in such a seriously crisis-ridden system, which is broken at all levels, right from investigation to legal representation to trial to sentencing to appeals to mercy jurisdiction, right? Irrespective of what your position is philosophically on the death penalty, and I'm not going to go into that, right, on your philosophical positions, does it make sense to have this kind of punishment in a system like this? Ours is a system that is where torture is rampant, right? And there is something in the Evidence Act which facilitates that, right? This really strange provision called Section 27 of the Indian Evidence Act, right? It's curious, right? A confession to a police officer is inadmissible in a court of law, but why do then the cops still torture people, right? I'm assuming not everybody has done evidence law yet, so pardon me if I'm dumbing this down, right? Basically, what does Section 27 say, right? If Anoop murdered Siddharth, right, and the cops arrest me, if I tell the cops I murdered Siddharth, I can confidently tell that, right? I can tell that. That is inadmissible. But if I say, I murdered Siddharth with this knife from my kitchen, I stabbed him properly, right? And then took this knife and hid it under the bridge near the lake. That part of my statement that leads to the recovery of that fact is admissible in a court of law. That is why they torture me. To say that, not that I murdered Siddharth. Right? They want a statement from me which will lead to the recovery of that evidence. And in court, I am then stuck having to explain to a judge as to how did I know where the knife with which Siddharth was murdered has been hidden. Right? That is what Section 27 does. Section 27 permits that. Right? And given, and the constitutionality of Section 27 was last challenged about, I don't know, more than 55 years ago, right? In the early 60s, I think, right? And I think it is seriously time to revisit the constitutionality of Section 27, right? And the argument is, if we don't do it, if we don't have Section 27, we are not even going to get the convictions that we get now. Anyway, we have a very low rate of convictions. If you don't have Section 27 also, which is basically saying if you don't allow us to torture people, we won't even get the kind of convictions we are getting. Right? The question really to ask is, one question is, are such convictions reliable? Right? And even if you say, well, let's not get into that, the question is, as a society committed to constitutionalism and the rule of law, do you want to achieve convictions in this manner? Right? Now, that's the reason why I wanted, and I want you to think about this gap in legal representation and free legal aid at the police custody level and the existence of Section 27 of the Evidence Act together are a potent combination, right? You have, you don't have legal representation and in police custody, the police are allowed to use this kind of statements that you make to them to recover evidence and use it in a court of law, right? Now those, it's a potent combination, and I think constitutional adjudication on criminal law needs to increasingly start looking at these systemic realities. But if at all anything, you will see that the trajectory of judicial decisions coming from the Supreme Court on criminal law have consistently watered down protections available to the accused. Right? If you look at the Supreme Court's performance on special legislations, be it TADA, POTA, or the MCOCA, or the GUCCOCA, or all these organized crime legislations, right? You will see how deferential the court is. Right? You will see how deferential the court is to executive determination of what needs to be done in response to national security challenges. Right? And the court is certainly not so deferential in certain other aspects. Right? But when it comes to questions of national security, the court has always been, I don't know if it's too wide a claim to make, but anyway, right? If you read the decisions that uphold the validity of all these legislations, you will see how deferential they are. Right? So, in essence, we are saying it's okay. I mean, it's okay that we chip away at these rights, we chip away at these basic constitutional protections to get convictions. Right? It's a price that we are willing to pay. Right? And there's nothing wrong with it. That's, in essence, what the message the court is sending, right? And that's a message that we also seem to be accepting, right? Now, I realize that much of what I'm saying now in terms of both legal representation, police custody, and Section 27 of the Evidence Act are applicable across the criminal justice system and are not unique in that sense to death row prisoners. But as I said, what I want you to reflect on is the criminal justice system and the contours of the criminal justice system within which the death penalty in this country operates, right? Another issue to really think about, and now more specifically on the death penalty really, right, is should the prosecution at the stage of framing of charges, should the prosecution at the stage of framing of charges, right, declare to the court that it is going to seek the death penalty, right? Should the court and the defense lawyers have advance notice right at the stage of framing of charges that they will seek the death penalty at the sentencing stage? Will that cure many of our ills? Will the court then be forced to examine evidence much more closely if they know that, you know, the prosecution is going to ask for the death sentence if the conviction is affirmed, or if the conviction, if they convict the accused before them, right? But I think it seems like a neat and convenient solution. And another thing in its favor is that for the sentencing phase, which we will talk about, it gives advance notice to the defense lawyers to start gathering information for mitigation. Right? There's aggravating factors and there are mitigating factors. It gives advance notice to the lawyer, to the defense lawyer, that we are going to be asking for the death penalty in this case. So why don't you start gathering mitigating evidence? Because what happens now is that the lawyer gets about one day at best. Right? The lawyer is today the conviction is, the 302 conviction is upheld. Right? And then they say, okay, tomorrow sentencing, right? And the lawyer is supposed to magically produce mitigation evidence or mitigation arguments, and we'll get to the problem with that, right? But does a system which has advanced notice that the death penalty is going to be sought solve some of those problems, right? But the problem with an advance notice system of the prosecution at the trial court stage, saying that, you know, at the framing of charges stage, saying this, is that there might just be a spike in, and I mean, I think what will happen really is prosecutors by default in 302 cases will start asking for the death penalty, right? They're not going to, in that sense, apply their mind at that stage and say, you know, let's ask for life imprisonment in this case. They'll say, okay, let's ask for the death penalty in all cases. And the moment the death penalty is asked for, all sorts of things, all kinds of pressures come into play, right? So this whole, while it certainly cures a sort of many issues that you might have with the fairness of the trial process in death penalty cases, and the major one among them being weak evidence, right? Well, it might solve that. I think it might give rise to prosecutors seeking more and more death sentences, right? Again, as I said, I'm not going to leave you with any answers on this sort, and I thought my job should be to present directions in which we could go and the consequences of choosing certain directions, right? And the, during the trial phase, I think the major concern in death penalty cases is how sentencing happens, right? I mean, all of you know that Bachchan Singh said, rarest of the rare, there has to be a balance of aggravating and mitigating circumstances. There is a list of mitigating circumstances in Bachchan Singh, right? But what does a lawyer have to do, right, to present mitigation evidence? And you have to understand a certain reality of the death penalty in this country, right? The work we did, we've shown that 76% of India's death row prisoners are extremely poor. Despite being poor, quite counterintuitively, we found that at the trial court stage and at the high court stage, 65% of them have private lawyers. The explanation for that is that there is this deep-seated fear of the legal aid system, the deep-seated fear of legal aid lawyers, that families will do anything, sell anything that they have, drive themselves into further debt to get a private lawyer, even if it means paying that private lawyer about 100 rupees per appearance, right? And given the fact that that lawyer is getting only that much, the representation you get is also of that quality, right? It is unheard of, really, that defense lawyers go and meet the prisoners that we spoke to, that they ever met them during the trial in prison, had detailed conversations, as you might see in Hollywood movies, sitting across a table, discussing evidence, you know, discussing their alibi. Nothing of that sort happens, right? The only time the prisoner meets the lawyer is in court, when he'll say, "Sab, mera case ka kya ho raha hai?" The lawyer will just be irritated and say, "Main dekh raha hu na." There is no discussion of evidence with the prisoner. There is no asking for explanation or saying, "Oh, this prosecution witness is saying this, what do you have to say?" Nothing of that sort happens. It happens with Sunil Bharti Mittal. It does not happen with a vast majority of India's death row prisoners, right? And in that sense, sentencing is a complete sham in death penalty trials, right? In sentencing, defense lawyers are meant to present mitigating evidence. And when you say mitigating evidence, you just, if you read death penalty judgments, you will see that, oh, he's poor, has a family, is married, has children. That's not mitigating evidence. A proper mitigation investigation and proper mitigation evidence is meant to reconstruct for the court the entire life history of this person, right? And that takes time, that takes effort, and that takes money, right? How was this person as a child? Is there a history of physical abuse? Is there a history of sexual abuse? As what is the sexual history of this person? Is there substance dependence? Right? What is the family history? And please remember that at the sentencing stage, presenting this mitigation evidence is not meant to justify the crime. It is not being presented as a justification. Right? It is meant to give the court a full understanding of the person that it is going to punish. It is meant to tell the court that this person before you is not defined purely by the crime that he or she has committed. Is not to reduce the identity of the prisoner to that one event. Just like none of us would like to be defined by any one incident in our lives. It's the defense lawyer's job and the court's duty to seek this mitigation evidence. And it never happens. And it goes to the heart of it being an unfair trial. You cannot have a death penalty trial and call it a fair trial without this kind of exhaustive mitigation evidence being presented. And as I said, it is not meant to justify the crime. It is only meant to give the court a holistic picture of who the prisoner is. Right? And this just does not happen for various reasons. It's time consuming. Lawyers rarely know they're given. Sometimes the sentencing hearing is done within a couple of hours. We handle cases now where death sentencing hearings were not done, right? And in such cases, the court says, okay, fine, you've shown us that the sentencing hearing was not done, or during the sentencing hearing, the lawyer was not present, the defense lawyer, right? So fine, you know, you argue before us. That's the court's response. The court's response, argue before us. Yes, we agree with you, sentencing has not taken place properly. Argue before us. Now please remember what Justice Nariman said in Mohammad Arif. He said different judicial minds can come to different conclusions. So therefore I as a prisoner have the right for my sentencing hearing to be heard by one trial court judge, two high court judges and three Supreme Court judges. So suddenly in the Supreme Court can't tell me that we will remedy this serious procedural infirmity ourselves. For the first time, the proper sentencing hearing will be done before us. We are not going to send it back to the trial court. That is in effect denying me the opportunity that three other judges would have heard my case. And maybe they would have come to a different conclusion. Right? And that leads me to the next issue of whether we must push for a position that the death sentence cannot be carried out until all judges across all levels have agreed. That even if there is a single dissent, you cannot be executed. Right? That even if one judicial mind feels that this person, and there are cases abound like that where judges have disagreed in the High Court, it has gone to a third judge, judges have dissented in the Supreme Court and they continue to be on death row because the majority of judges thought they must continue to be on death row. Whether in death sentences cases, whether as being a special category of cases, there must be unanimous opinion. And unless there is unanimity across all judicial levels, right, the death sentence should not be carried out. Right? That you cannot legally take life, that even if one judge feels that this person does should not be killed. Right? The next issue I want to talk about in sentencing is on the role of socioeconomic factors, poverty, illiteracy, right? What is their role? And I think we very often in our understanding we confuse what role they're meant to play. On the one hand, they're meant to play this role that it shows a sort of systemic discrimination against the poor and the marginalized, right? But in an individual case, can I go and say that I am being discriminated against because I'm poor? Right? And I think I would sort of go with that argument which says that the poverty and illiteracy and marginalization argument plays out very differently in an individual case versus if you were litigating the constitutionality of the death penalty. If it is a strategic litigation, this issue of poverty and marginalization plays out very differently. Because in an individual case, you have to then show how that has prejudiced your case. How has your caste prejudiced your case? How has poverty prejudiced your case? How has illiteracy prejudiced your case? And that is very difficult to show. It might be relevant to the extent of showing the judge who I am. In constructing that life history, as I was saying, it might be relevant to that. But I don't think you can take it to the next step and say, I have been discriminated because of this in an individual case. But certainly, if you are challenging the constitutionality of the death penalty, this kind of information would be crucial to show that the burden of the death penalty falls disproportionately on the poor, on the socially backward, and in our study we found that 23% of India's death row prisoners had not even gone to school for a single day, right? They had not even entered school. And about 62% had not completed secondary education, right? So these are the people we're talking about, right? And I think to serve us well to keep that in mind when we talk of constitutional rights, constitutional protections, solutions, our objections, it would serve us well to keep that in mind, right? Now I'll just move to the mercy jurisdiction, and here I want to discuss Yakub Memon's case, right? But before I get to Yakub Memon, the way mercy gets filed in this country, right, by virtue of the kind of people that we're talking about, is that jails have a standard format of a mercy petition. Right? They're almost like bad law firms, right? It's templates, right? Death by templates, right? Now, in terms of, there is a template, the prisoner doesn't know that he or she can have access to a lawyer at that stage, does not have access to a lawyer, the prison doesn't bother to inform them, but a mercy petition has to be sent because the jail manual requires them to do so. So they just fill out the name and send it to the president, right? That is how a large proportion of mercy petitions get filed in this country, right? It is not some great thought out case being made to the president that, you know, if these are my individual circumstances, these are people who can't even read or write. They just put their thumb impression where the prison official asks them to put the thumb impression, that's all. And then they just keep waiting. Right? Now the president's consideration of mercy is another interesting constitutional question. If you read Maru Ram and you read Kehar Singh, right? They have said it is a constitutional power. It fits into the constitutional matrix. It is part of the constitutional scheme. But yet, the very basic administrative law protections that are given to actions that have far less consequences are not given to the mercy jurisdiction. They have said, yes, we can review. Yes, we can judicially review the mercy, the decision on the mercy petition on limited administrative law grounds. That the court can't substitute its opinion for that of the president, but it can take up limited administrative law review on things like, were all relevant materials considered? Were irrelevant materials considered? Was there a mala fide? Right? But they have said, no personal hearing. The president need not give a hearing. Right? And the president need not give reasons. On the one hand, you're saying it is part of the constitutional framework and the constitutional mechanism. And at the same time, and you have discarded the theory that it's some sort of sovereign prerogative. And you've rejected that entire theory and you've gone down this road, but then you're not taking it to its logical conclusion. We don't get to see how an Indian prison is. We don't get to see how a prisoner on death row in India is treated. what those jail conditions are, what are the restrictions on their lives. How inhumane that treatment is. And it's on all of our conscience, right? That we choose to turn a blind eye to this. And I think that brings me to the question of reform, right? And that's so integral to death penalty sentencing. Can you show the ability to reform? And the favorite response to this is from Sessions Court judges, High Court judges, Supreme Court judges. Oh, that is an impractical requirement in Bachchan Singh. We can't show that. Now, Bachchan Singh said it, but that's impractical. We can't show it. But that is essentially the idea of Bachchan Singh, that it makes it very difficult to execute somebody. So if you can't show it, the default option is not to say, yeah, we'll ignore it. And how do you show reformation? No death penalty case in this country in the last 15 years has ever considered conduct in jail. That is what you would consider, right? You can't decide my ability to be reformed based on the crime I committed, which is what so many of the cases do. Or this person cannot be reformed because he has raped and murdered a 3-year-old. But that's just getting it all mixed up, right? My ability to be reformed must be a function of how I am in prison. That information must be called for, but it is never called for. And as a result, our entire death penalty jurisprudence then gets focused purely on the brutality of the crime. Which is great as a social response, that's fine. But as a legal constitutional response, that is not what is required of the judges. And as lawyers, it's incumbent upon us to make that distinction between a social response and a legal response. We can sit in with our families and have the most regressive of views, but as a lawyer, there are certain rules of the game, right? And that brings me. Have I overshot my time? Yeah, that's it. I'm going to finish. My last point really is on this alternative of life imprisonment without the possibility of release, right? Developed in Sriharan, there's a Rajiv Gandhi assassination case, right? Whether that makes any sense, really. I know a lot of people who work on the death penalty welcome that, right? Because it is surely, or they think it is going to see a reduction in death sentences. The judgment in Sriharan says that the High Court or the Supreme Court, for an offense that attracts the death penalty, can choose to sentence a person to a life in prison, excluding the powers of remission of the state. Basically saying that they can order somebody to stay in prison for the rest of their natural life without the possibility of release, without the possibility of review of punishment. They have to stay in jail for the rest of their lives. I do not think it is any victory for the abolitionists, right? This is just nitpicking cruelty for me, right? What are we trying to say? What are we really trying to say when we say you stay in jail for the rest of your life? I will never review your punishment. I will never give you parole. I will never give you any furlough. You stay in prison for the rest of your life. For me, it is an admission of the failure of our prison system. Saying that we cannot reform you. We cannot even try to do anything. Right? There is nothing what their name that in any of the prisons that we visited that moves prisoners towards reformation. And since you are systemically incapable of that, and you are worried about reoffending, right? You are worried that prisoners if let out would reoffend. You then make the choice that let's sacrifice the rights of the prisoner, right? Let's sacrifice those individual rights and keep that person in prison for the rest of their life, because we are incapable of developing a system really which can in some senses reform that person and reduce the risk of reoffending. And therefore we try to address the risk of reoffending by keeping them in prison for the rest of their life, right? That, I mean, and as you will see, much of what I have said today has nothing to do with the philosophical positions on the death penalty or the political positions on the death penalty, right? I've deliberately steered clear of that because I think on that question, and as a legal question, and I think that was the error in Bachchan Singh, there was no data. It was just a pure philosophical political argument. And there is nothing to say that which side is correct or which side is true or which is a truth in this case, right? And therefore as a legal discussion, at least personally, I feel that on the question of the death penalty, we need to focus on the systemic realities of the criminal justice system. Why we cannot have such a punishment in a system like this, that's patently violent, brutal and unfair. And that makes the punishment all the more cruel and degrading and inhuman. Thank you.